Alleluia. Alleluia.
And blessed be his kingdom now and forever. Amen. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Blessed Lord and Father,
yes, we have
in your name
and in fellowship of one another. Enable us by your grace to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to proclaim and respond to your holy word. Teach us to pray for your word and your church. Grant us that we confess in our sins, the word we offer to you of our souls and bodies as we
The first reading is written chapter 17, verses 22 to 31.
I read it from the Word of God, written in Acts chapter 17, verses 23 to 31. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, Ephesians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For I went to the city and observed the objects of your worship. I found among them an altar with the inscription, to an unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything. Since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things, from one ancestor, he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they could live, so that they could search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him. Though indeed, he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and have our being. As your own prophet said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. The word of the Lord.
Psalm 66, verses 7 to 18. The second reading from the first letter of Peter, chapter 3, verses 13 to 22.
Who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated. But in your hearts, sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands an accounting for the hope that is in you. Yet, do it with gentleness and reverence. Keep your conscience clear, so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for the sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, 8 persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of the Lord.
be with you. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John 14, chapter in another fifth verse. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides with you, and he will be with you, in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them." This is the Gospel of Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. The 15th and 16th verses of the 14th chapter of the Gospel according to John. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. In the Gospel lesson, according to John chapter 14, the Gospel lesson appointed for today, the sixth Sunday of Easter, our Lord prepares his disciples for his departure. The Gospel lesson forms part of what is referred to as the farewell discourses of Jesus. For the disciples, the real time was actually before the resurrection, before his crucifixion, death, burial, and resurrection. And so for them, it was a difficult time. They did not have the privilege that we do of knowing that Jesus rose again from the dead, and knowing that he ascended into heaven and of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. The disciples had placed all their hopes and trust in Jesus. He was their comforter, the one who gave them courage. He was their counselor. He was their advocate. He was their companion and guide. And as Jesus himself had said, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. The disciples had become so familiar and accustomed to his presence and company. And here is Jesus, knowing that his departure was approaching, prepares them for this eventuality. For he knew what it would mean for them. So he prepares them for it. As I said, the real time for the disciples was before his crucifixion, before his death, before his burial, before his resurrection, ascension, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. For us, in real time, it is after his crucifixion, it is after his resurrection, it is after his ascension, it is after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, it is after the church had come up with the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. Liturgically for us, it is on the sixth Sunday of Easter, before the ascension of our Lord. For the disciples, it was a shock for them, for they had no knowledge, no understanding that Jesus would die, and that he would rise again. But for us liturgically, Jesus is alive. He rose again from the dead. And we are preparing to celebrate his ascension and subsequent outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and to also give thanks to God for the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. It is like, for the disciples, it was like someone who has been a tower of strength to us, one in whom we confided in, one who has always been there for us to all the challenges of life, a faithful companion and guide. And this person has to leave us and go away. That is the context in which Jesus prepares his disciples for his departure. John, the gospel writer, in the gospel that bears his name, focuses on the importance of love in our relationship with God and each other. First of all, he emphasizes the magnitude of God's love. In John chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, he wrote, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, that the world through him might be saved." In the gospel lesson for today, the sixth Sunday of Easter, as our Lord prepares his disciples for his departure, as we liturgically prepare to celebrate the ascension of our Lord and look forward to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit liturgically, and to celebrate the doctrine of the Holy Trinity, John emphasizes the centrality of love. Our Lord prepares his disciples for his departure, focuses on the centrality of love. As we prepare to celebrate the ascension, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and the doctrine of the Holy Trinity, we are called to focus on the centrality of love. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, says Jesus. In John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, John quotes Jesus as saying, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." In the gospel, according to Matthew, chapter 22, verses 34 to 39, when the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Matthew 22, 34 to 39. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." Love issues in obedience. Love is exercised through obedience. And obedience here does not speak of being rigid, legalistic, or regimental. It is not that if we do not do it, we fear that we'll be punished. Rather, through our relationship with Jesus, we have come to believe and know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that the meaning and purpose of life is found in God through His Son, Jesus Christ. So we are obedient to His commandments because we believe and know that they lead to fullness of life, abundant life. It is the way of salvation. For example, in our family, our workplace, organization, we are not obedient to the policies and regulations because we are afraid in the workplace that they'll fire us, or in the organization we'll be dismissed, or in our homes our parents may punish us. But rather we are obedient and follow them because we know, we understand that they are there for the proper functioning of the family, the workplace, and the organization. Therefore, the upliftment and well-being of the organization and of those who are part of the family, the workplace, and the organization. And so as we journey through this pandemic, the coronavirus, we are not obedient to the protocols because we are afraid that we will be punished. But we do so out of love of God, out of love to our neighbor, our brothers and sisters. We do so because we recognize it is for the well-being and safety of all. And so I urge you to continue to be obedient and to follow the protocols laid out for us by our Ministry of Health. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. There's a story of a woman, Christian woman, very much involved in the life of her church. As she journeyed through her life, she looked forward to the day when she would settle down and get married. She had several relationships. Unfortunately, none of them resulted in marriage. And so as she got older, she became very desperate. And she decided to pray more earnestly. She fasted and prayed for a week. She told her friend that she was going to do so, to ask God to present her with a good man, a good husband. So she prayed and she prayed and she fasted. At the end of the week, she went to work as usual, and on that day, a gentleman came in to do business, and for some reason, he spoke to her, and they developed a relationship, and her friend met her and said to her, "What happened? The week is gone." And she said, "God answered my prayer. God had given me a wonderful man, a man who takes good care of me. He is compassionate, loving, and caring. I never had such an experience before. I believe this is the one for me." So a friend said, "But who is he?" When she told the friend the name of the man, the friend almost collapsed. The friend said to her, "But he is a married man." She said, "God sent him for me." "If you love me, you will keep my commandments," says Jesus. There was a man who had to catch a flight to go overseas. He lived 1 hour away from the airport. And so he contacted his friend to come and pick him up at 5 o'clock to take him to the airport. So he got up and began to prepare. His friend called him 4:45. He said, "I'm sorry, my vehicle is broken down, so I can't come for you." So he became worried. He started to pray, said, "God, what must I do? Who can I call at this hour to take me to the airport? Lord, please help me." As he started to think who he can call to take him to the airport, he looked out of his window and he saw a vehicle right in front of his gate. So he went outside. The engine was running. Nobody was in the vehicle. So he said, "God sent this vehicle for me." So he went for his luggage, put it in the vehicle, and drove to the airport. When he was checking in, the police came and arrested him. Stole a vehicle. His neighbor, an old woman who lived by herself, was very ill and called her son to take her to the airport, to the hospital. So he came in a hurry, left the car running, and went to get her. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments," says Jesus. And thirdly, there's a professional footballer who was playing for this particular team for several years, over 5 years. And he had helped the team to win the championship for several years. Then before the new season, the owner of the club said to them that he had some new policies for the club. And so he laid them out to them. When he was finished, this professional politely and gently pointed out to him some flaws in the policy. He politely and gently pointed out to him some aspects of the policy which were disadvantageous to the players, which were not in the best interests of the players. He was summarily dismissed without even taking time to see whether there was any iota of truth, any validity in what he was saying. He was summarily dismissed. "If you love me," says Jesus, "you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever." As I said earlier, the disciples had placed all their hopes and trust in Jesus. He was their comforter, the one who gave them courage. He was their counselor. He was their advocate. He was their companion and guider. Jesus sought to prepare his disciples for his departure. So he said to them, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I'll pray the Father, and he will give you another advocate." It's important for us to reflect on what Jesus meant by another advocate. An example would be if you are at a function and you are drinking a glass of Moby, and someone says to you, "Would you like to have another drink?" It can mean two things. One would be, "Would you like to have a different drink? A glass of lemonade or orange juice?" Or it could mean, "Would you like to have another drink of Moby? Another glass of Moby?" The same thing. It is believed that in the gospel lesson, Jesus' reference to another advocate speaks of the same thing. So it speaks of another advocate who is the same as Jesus. This prepares us for the Trinity. For Jesus has said to us that he and the Father are one. And Jesus said to them in John 5:19, "Very truly I tell you, the Son can do nothing on his own, but only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, the Son does likewise." So even though Jesus will no longer be with his disciples physically, he has promised them another advocate, the Holy Spirit, to be with them. And he has said the advocate would be the same as he himself, who will be with them forever. So the disciples need not fear, for the comfort which they experience with Jesus, they will experience with the Holy Spirit. The same encouragement they receive from Jesus is the same they will have with the Holy Spirit. The same way they had placed all their hope, aspirations, and trust in Jesus, they can now place it in the Holy Spirit. And earlier in chapter 14, the gospel lesson for last Sunday, it began by Jesus saying to them, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me." So as they believe and trust in the Father, so they could believe and trust in the Son, and they could believe and trust in the Holy Spirit. "If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever." Jesus prepares his disciples for his departure. And the means through which the presence of Jesus, or they will know that he is present with them, is true love. Love of God, love of each other, and obeying his commandments. We learn in our catechism that Jesus has revealed to us that God is love. And so central to our relationship with God Central to our journey as Christians is love. So Jesus prepares his disciples for his departure with the understanding that the Holy Spirit will come, who would be just like the Father, who would be just like the Son. So there is no need for them to fear. And the means through which they would recognize his presence is true love. For God has shown his love for us. Central to the gospel of Jesus Christ is love. And through love, love of God, they will know that Jesus is present with them. Not only with them, but with us. Liturgically, we are preparing for the ascension to know that Jesus Christ, our Lord, Lord of Lords and King of Kings, is a God of love. We can trust him as we trust the Father. And the outpouring of the Holy Spirit continues that ministry of emphasizing the magnitude of God's love for us as a people. So we can trust him and go to him. And Jesus says he would be with us forever. And so as we journey through this pandemic, and we journey through all the experiences, the changing scenes of life, we can trust God because we know he is always present with us. And we are called to love God and love one another. So may we continue to adhere to the protocols, for they are for the well-being of us all. And may we, through this difficult time, many have lost their jobs, etc., may we seek to be our brothers and sisters keepers, because it's true love that we emphasize the presence of God with us. The good news, my brothers and sisters in Christ, is that the young lady who prayed and thought she had found the person for the rest of her life. The good news, my brothers and sisters in Christ, for that young man who prayed and thought that God had sent that vehicle for him. The good news, my brothers and sisters in Christ, for that owner of the club who dismissed the player summarily. The good news is that God is love. The same love which Jesus exhibited in dying upon the cross for our salvation, for our forgiveness, that same love is available to that woman. That same love is available to that young man. That love is still available to that owner of the club. They can receive that forgiveness, forgiven love of Jesus. And so my brothers and sisters in Christ, as we prepare to celebrate the ascension of our Lord, as we prepare for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and to celebrate the doctrine of the Holy Trinity, may we love God, love Jesus, and be obedient to his commandments. May we feel and know that the Holy Spirit is with us, that Jesus is with us, that God is with us, now and always. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
said a nice thing to him. Even one God.
Intercession Form C, page 108. With all our heart and all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord.
For the peace and welfare of the world, for the witness and work of the church, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our bishops and all ministers of God's word and sacraments, that they may be filled with truth and love, and be found without fault at the Lord's coming, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the leaders of the nations and for those in authority among us, that they may serve justice and promote the freedom and dignity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression, and for all who labor in the cause of human liberation and fulfillment, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick, the suffering, the sorrowful, and the dying, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance from the ravages of hurricane, earthquake, drought, or flood, and for a just and proper use of God's creation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For ourselves and all who confess the name of Christ, that we may show forth the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people in the multitude of your mercies. Look with compassion on us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O Lord of love, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Page 123, the Act of Penitence. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us therefore confess our sins. Almighty God,
blessed be you among others, in your authority, and in what we have done, we are sorry and repent for our sins. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant us to serve you in goodness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The kingdom of God is justice, peace, and joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Offertory hymn number 446. 446.
Amen.
me. Father, your field, these gifts that you have given us, this bread, this wine, this money, that we offer ourselves, our lives, and our work to become through your Holy Spirit a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice. As this bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ, so may we and all your people become channels of your love to the same Christ, our Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us eternal life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
When he given thanks, he gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, to be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Gifts of God for the people of God.
Our souls will feast and be satisfied, and we will sing glad songs of praise to you.
this side, go down that way. Those on this side, back that.
Communion hymn 607.
147, the first verse of Corinthians 12. Almighty Father, thank you for feeding us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ.
May we share his
body, the visible life.
We will drink this cup
and life for others.
We are upon whom your Spirit shines
in light of the world.
Help us to continue in faithful witness to your word.
So we and all your children shall be in the world of praise and name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The God of peace, brought again from the dead, our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of his sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to his will, working in you that is well pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
My brothers and sisters, we have no first-time visitors with us this morning, but we would like to acknowledge the presence of our ambassador to the United States, Brother Hobby Prince, and his daughter Diana. And also our sister Joyce Ayata. My brothers and sisters, this morning, well, last week we started back our services, and it's so nice to be worshiping again this morning. The devil thought that he had won this battle with us of these church doors being closed, but he has a great surprise that in each of us homes, God has opened a church for us still to worship.
For the gift of life, thank you for this your servant whom you have given to us, Lord, his gifts, talents, and skills as he shares with us. As he begins another year, pour your blessings upon him and continue to keep him faithful in your service. We ask this to Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and evermore.
To sanitize the church. That was an attempt to see how best we can make a transition.
our recessional hymn number 387, 387.
The Lord.